Israel.
Thank you, host, for the music that is ushering us into the program. I want to take the opportunity to welcome everybody into our divine service of the 21st of November, 2019. By the way, there's not going to be another 21st of November, 2020 divine service. So this is one of such a kind. And we want to thank the Lord that even in this, in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic, we're still able to come together and worship and praise him even on these and other platforms. Of course, I do know that there are others who are joining us, not only on Zoom, but on YouTube. Please feel welcome as well as we worship together as a church family, as children of God. We are going to open up our program with an opening song, which has been the theme song for our week of prayer, How Far From Home. And the host is going to play that song for us, and we can, of course, follow in our respective places. Thank you. Thank you again for that theme song. We shall have our first prayer offered by Shepherdess Mohano. First prayer by Shepherdess Mohano. You can unmute.
Let's pray. Our Father and our God, the creator of heaven and earth, the maker of man, the sustainer of life, we glorify your name this Sabbath morning. Not because we are worthy of calling upon this name, but because we know that you sent your one and only Son to come and die for us. And for that reason, that makes us to be able to call upon this name. We give glory and honor unto you. In a special way, Lord, we thank you for giving us yet another opportunity to sit at thy feet. Feed us now. We are here to listen. Yes, it is true that we are not very far from home. We have traveled so far because of your hand, because of your light that is upon our feet, showing us the way. Please keep us in faith. Keep us in your righteousness of hand so that we can be able to reach our glorious destination. Be with our speakers and our pastor as you be taking the divine service. May your hand of mercy be upon him. May he speak that which you have sent him to come and share for us, so that our faith can be strengthened and we can have that hope of the resurrection morning. This is our prayer in Christ's name and for his sake only. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Shepherdess, for that prayer. Again, a good welcome to everybody. And our next part of the program takes us to the children's sermonette, which is supposed to be rendered by Uncle Ivan. Can I just get confirmation that Uncle Ivan is on the platform with us? Uncle Ivan, if he's not on the platform, we'll move to the next step. And that will be our offertory, which will be rendered by our own pastor, Pastor Madava.
Thank you, Program Director. I greet the Church of God in the name of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Without any waste of time, I invite you to turn with me to the book of Exodus. I shall read Exodus chapter 30, and I'll read verse 11 through verse 12. Now the Bible says, "Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, 'When you take the census of the children of Israel for their number, then every man shall give a ransom for himself to the Lord. When you number them, that there may be no plague among them when you number them.'" Let us pray. Our Father, our God, speak to us. For we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I want to take these few moments first to reflect upon the realities of this year. Now, if I was to take you back from the beginning of the year, you will agree with me that it started off as any other year. Many prophecies were made to assume and suggest that this will be like any other year. But when the year then came to March, it was then clear that this was a different year altogether. We experienced job losses. You'll recall that even the statistics today suggest that there's never been so much job losses as this year. The only comparison closest to this year was made in 1994. And you look around yourself and you just find someone who has lost their job. I want to also bring to you to reflect on the fact that many have lost their lives. Thousands of thousands continue to lose their life in different ways. But with all this said, when your neighbors lose jobs, when your neighbors die, your colleagues, for some reason, you and I have not. And I want to perhaps ask you, is it because you and I are better than they? Is it because you and I are more educated than they? Is it because you and I are more healthy and our immune system is better than theirs? Is it because of something about us that we are alive today? Is it because of something about us that we are able to get a salary or whatever means that we get today? Is it because of us that we have what we have? And with that, I want to suggest to you and me this morning that it is simply because of the mercies and the grace of the Lord. There is nothing else that can explain why we have what we have today. There is nothing else that can explain why we are alive today, save the fact that God has been good to us. Now, the psalmist then says, "What shall I render unto the Lord for all his goodness towards me?" I want to call you to, in the few minutes that I have, to the text that I read. Now, the Israelites, even as they were in the wilderness, I'm taking for granted that every one of us understand the ministry of tithe and offering. I will not talk about the tithe and offering as we know it, because I believe that if it is the Lord who brought us this far, if it is the Lord who has provided for us, there is nothing else we can do than to be grateful for the things that you have done for us, to be grateful even in time of our. I'll take for granted that all of us who are listening to me have been faithful. How can you not be faithful when God has been so good to you? Now, when you read Exodus chapter 30, you discover that as they're going through the wilderness, as God is outlining the sanctuary ministries, the building of the sanctuary and all the things, and this was in line with the plan of salvation. Now, God comes after having introduced the altar of incense in chapter 30. He talks about through Moses and ransom money. Now, this, what some will call it, an atonement money. This was money, half a shekel, that every single person will bring to God, age 20 and above. And this was a common amount given by God's people. And this was given for every person who was counted as member of Israel. Now, I just want to draw two things before I appeal to you and pray with you. Number one, Israel understood that they don't deserve, Romans 3:23, all have sinned. They don't deserve to be counted amongst God's people. Now they have sinned. They are not in any way deserving to be among God's people. Now for the fact that they are counted among those that are called by God's name, they saw it a privilege. And for that reason, they brought this ransom money. And secondly to it, it was an issue of identity. Their identity was with God, not with anyone. They would have gone through a time where others would have not made it. Some would have died. Some would have not made it through illnesses and other ways, but they were count among the living. And for this, they came to the Lord with this ransom money when they were counted and presented to the Lord for the ministration of the sanctuary. Now, what am I saying to you this morning? I'm proposing, and allow me, program director, to make a submission to us. Now, this has not been an easy year. Many have not made it. Many might still not make it to the end of the year. But what do we have for the Lord to say, Lord, thank you for keeping me? What do we have to say to the Lord? This year has been difficult. This year has been rough, but you have kept me. I want to make a proposal to someone who's listening to me that even as we go through this year, on the 13th Sabbath, the last Sabbath of this year, you and I deserve to bring and ransom money to the Lord to say, Lord, when others could not make it, not because I'm better than they, you have preserved me and I have no other reason but to be grateful to you. And I want to pray that this be our commitment, even as we go to the last year of the last Sabbath of the month, where we bring offerings to the Lord in gratitude, not only being alive, but being counted among God's people. May God bless us. Our eyes are closed and we are praying together. Our Father, our God, we want to thank you. We thank you, Father, for life. We thank you, Father, for providence. Tonight, Lord, we want to thank you for the reality that when others could not make it, by grace and mercy, we are here, we've made it. And with those that are making this commitment with me today, we're saying, Lord, on that last Sabbath of this year, the last Sabbath of December, we will bring unto the Lord that which is a special offering in gratitude for the things that you have done for us. And we shall lay it at your temple, Lord, and present it to your God, to you as your God, and say, Lord, thank you for keeping us. Lord, thank you for counting us amongst the living. Thank you for counting us amongst your people. This is our prayer this morning in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We want to thank our pastor for that very important and powerful message for us to be even faithful stewards in this time. I believe our pastor, Pastor Uncle Ivan, is now on the platform and will give him the opportunity to quickly come in and give us the service for the children. Uncle Ivan, if you can unmute. Okay. And, yes.
Okay, can you hear me, Elder Chirisa?
Yes, Chakarisa, yes, we can hear you very well.
Well, I've quickly dashed out of church, but let me quickly go on to the program. My video, I think, okay, I'm using my phone, so it's fine. Greetings, beloved Church of God, and thank you, my good pastor, for that beautiful, beautiful piece about the offering. May the Lord bless you totally and completely. And to the young boys and girls, it's so exciting to know that we are taking this journey with our parents. And remember, as the children of Israel, we're journeying from the land of bondage into the land that flows with milk and honey, even with their children. And Moses says, we'll go with our old, we'll go with our young and our children. So this journey is a journey that we take as families. And I'm so excited to share with you. Well, today, I just want to share a beautiful piece that I'm going to share with you before we get to listen to the beautiful words, the wonderful words that the Lord has prepared for us as we come to the end of this journey that prepares us for the actual journey that we will make. A story is told about a teacher who was having her kids in class. And the teacher was talking about how important a journey is. And he asked, they just come from the holidays, not a huge holiday that, like the one that we had because of COVID-19, but it was a normal holiday. It was after the Christmas holidays or the festive holidays. So they were in a new class and the teacher asked the kids, guys, do you have a journey that you'd want to share? So children started raising their hands. Yes, teacher. And one says, no, I took a beautiful journey. We traveled from Africa. We went to Spain. We saw this and that. And people would say, wow. And they'd get amazed and they would listen to each and every journey that all the kids had traveled. But there was this one guy, his name was called Bombo Mujamuraho Tsotsotso Chimwemwe Chimwemwe Liken Liken Jojitang. Well, because the name is quite so long, let's just call him Bombo. But everyone was surprised that Bombo is not the one who's so excited about his journey. He's not raising his hand. He's just looking and people are telling about their journeys and they're nodding. But Bombo was just quiet. So the teacher was a little bit concerned. So the teacher said to Bombo, Bombo, maybe you didn't take a journey. Did you go anywhere else? And then Bombo said to the teacher, well, I took a journey, but my journey was not like all these other journeys that other kids took, because I took my journey every day of my holiday. And they were like, you took a journey every day of my holiday? He says, yes, it was a journey through the Bible. So the people were like, journey through the Bible? What is that form of a journey? He says, well, I hope you'll understand, but let me tell you my journey, because it was such an interesting journey. For my journey, beloved friends, began at Genesis, right through Exodus. On the way, we saw Leviticus recording the numbers of people at Deuteronomy, while Joshua was waiting at the beautiful gate for judges to see Ruth calling out loudly, Samuel, Samuel. At a stage, the first and second kings of Chronicles were waiting to visit Ezra and Nehemiah and Esther to go and see their beloved brother who had gone through a misfortune and his name was Job. They started singing Psalms and teaching children Proverbs concerning Ecclesiastes and Songs of Solomon. This coincided with the period that Isaiah and Jeremiah were engaged in lamentation together with Ezekiel and Daniel, their friend. By that time, Amos and Obadiah were not around. 3 days later, Hosea, Joel, and Jonah traveled in the same ship with Nahum to Jerusalem. More also, Habakkuk visited Zephaniah, who introduced him to Haggai, a friend of Zechariah, whose cousin is Malachi.
We seem to be losing the pastor.
Yes, my elder.
Hello? Can hear you.
Can I go ahead?
Go ahead.
Immediately after the old tradition, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John got involved in the acts with the Romans, who were always at loggerheads with the Corinthians, who were behaving like the Galatians. The Ephesians, too, realizing that the Philippians were closer to the Colossians, suggested to Thessalonians that they should first of all see Timothy, who was a friend of Titus, whose cousin is Philemon, suggested to them that they must be able to read Hebrew, and told his friend James, who was exclaimed by Peter, and told the three Johns how to reveal the revelation of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And everybody was like, wow, what a journey through the Bible. And every child who was in class said, now we are going to make our own journey to read and understand what God would want us to do from the book of Revelation, from the book of Genesis, right to the book of Revelation, so that we know about this Jesus in the Bible. And says, my friends, that is my journey. I hope you enjoyed my journey, and I hope you take a journey through the Bible. I want to challenge you, my beloved boys and girls at Golden Harvest. There are so many journeys we can make in this world. We can take a journey to the Eiffel Tower, I think it's in Paris. We can go to see Burj Khalifa in Dubai. We can go and see the Statue of Liberty in the United States of America. But until we take a journey through the Bible, we'll never get home. But this is the journey that takes us to the home that flows with milk and honey. My challenge to you is make a daily journey through the Bible. Understand what God would want us to do. So may God bless you as you take a journey through the Bible each day of your life. When you do so, God will bless you totally and completely. May the good Lord bless you. And now it's almost time for us to hear the Lord speak to us through the main service. So sit back, relax, and tell yourself, I am going to take this journey with my Lord. May the good Lord bless you totally and completely. Amen and amen.
Amen, Pastor. Thank you very much for such a beautiful sermon. And we know the children on the platform have really learned a lot. I want to take the opportunity, members, to welcome and introduce our speaker for Divine Service, none other than the president of the SID. I just texted a message just to see how many churches are in the SID, but we are so fortunate that of the many churches that he could have been on their platform or physically in their churches, the Lord has directed him to be with us here. And I'm sure there is a message that God wants us to hear from him. Dr. Maposa, we want to welcome you. Pastor Maposa, I know that you don't want this title here. Pastor Maposa, we want to welcome you. And we know that you have never disappointed, and the Lord has continued to use you in a special way. But before you speak to us, somebody is going to traditionally raise you from your seat, and that will be Elder Mofaro Mberi, who is a special item. And the place.
Amen. Elder Mofaro, you can take over.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm going to sing a familiar hymn. When peace like a river attendeth my soul, when sorrows like billows roll, it is well with my soul. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Nails to the cross, and I
bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. A trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul.
Pastor, it's your time.
Thank you so very much for the invitation and for the powerful music. But I'm thinking the devil is against us today because I continue being cut off. I don't know if I'm the only one who's experiencing that. We get cut off and come back, cut off and come back. Here where I am at Rayton, there's no electricity and I'm connected through my phone. So, but anyway, the devil is a loser. He may try to roar like a lion, but we know that he doesn't have teeth. His teeth were removed at the cross of Calvary, so there is nothing that he will do. We only will conquer him through the Lamb. I'm really excited to be part of this worship. I always look forward to worshiping with you, my brothers and sisters, at Golden Harvest. When I was invited, of course, I couldn't resist. If it was some other church, perhaps I would have given a reason. But Golden Harvest sounds and smells like home. All the time I am with you, I feel like I'm at home. So thank you so much for the beautiful children's story, my pastor. That was, you really did us proud. Thank you so much, and I'm sure our kids learned a lot. The journey home. I took time to think about the journey home. What should one talk about when the theme is the journey home? I thought of, doing a sermon that I normally do when I'm conducting an effort, and I reminded myself that, no, these are members. They don't need that. I spend a lot of time thinking, but I finally concluded that, it is possible for somebody to get on the journey home and get lost somewhere, or for some people to confidently walk the direction of home and never get there. I thought I should start where the ABCs are, so that all of us, when we journey home, we are ensured that we get the courage, that we get the hope, that we are assured, we get the assurance of making it home. Because as we journey home, there is not one soul who is going to make it home when they travel home, depending on themselves and on their strengths. All who will make it home will make it depending fully and trusting fully on our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So shall we bow our heads and pray. Electricity has come back, praise God. So maybe there will be a little disturbance as I connect back to the normal.
Host, you can just have a short song as the pastor is reconnecting. Are you back, Mfundisi?
I knew that things like this will happen.
Yeah.
So I was just going to start praying. Shall we pray together? My Heavenly Father, I'm before you on this beautiful Sabbath day, pleading with you and asking you, Father, that you'll talk to our hearts this morning and that you'll give us the assurance of salvation, and that by the time we are through with the service, our sins may be forgiven, and that will all be washed and made new in the blood of Jesus Christ. Wash us, talk to us, Lord, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. The journey back home. I entitled my sermon, But God. But God. I find my
you seem to be frozen, Pastor. Are you back, Mfundisi? Pastor, are you back? You are muted?
Yeah, now I am back. I think I'm back now.
Thank you, Pastor.
Yeah, we didn't have electricity, so it has just come. So I knew that we were going to have these kinds of things. I had prayed, but I'll pray again. Let us pray. My gracious Father, as we go into your word, may you please talk to our hearts. May we accept you again as Lord of our lives. And may we leave this service with our sins forgiven and ready to go home with you when you come to take us. Talk to us through your word today in Jesus' name. Amen. The journey home. I had just said to remind the saints that the journey home is not a journey that one can embark on their own, because if you do so, you will not make it home. The journey home can only be successfully taken as one leans on the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There is no one who trusts on himself. There is no one who depends on their own power to make it to the kingdom who will make it there. only the only people who are going to make it home are those whose sins have been forgiven, those who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb, those who have accepted Jesus as their Savior, those who trust Jesus, those who are not wearing a righteousness of their own, but those who are clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. They are the only ones who will make it to heaven. And so that's why I decided that today, as we talk about the journey home, I am going to start at the very basics. We are going to consider the very basics. And if we come out right here, we are making it home. If you don't come out right here, you are not making it home. If I don't come out right this in this that I'm going to talk about, we are not making it home. That's why I entitled my sermon today, "But God, But God." Let's find our way to the book of Ephesians. We are looking at Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, and I read from the first verse going up to the fourth, and I may continue even beyond the fourth verse. The Bible says, talking about us, yes, the Apostle Paul was writing to the Ephesians, but we are the Ephesians today. So the Apostle Paul is writing to us, and he is saying, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed in the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving wrath." What a passage. What a passage. By nature, we were deserving wrath. And then what happened? What did we do to make it right with God? Where did we make the about turn? What did we do right so that God can accept us? Because the Bible says, "As for you, you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once lived." But then he says, we all were among them. You look at verse 3. All of us also lived among them. This is a problem. It's not a problem of them. It's a problem of us. This is a universal problem. The Bible talking about us here, it says we were dead in sins. Before I get into that, I want to make an observation, because this chapter of Ephesians, it has been noted that the first three verses of Ephesians are a three-verse summary of the first three chapters of the book of Romans. In other words, the first three verses of the book of Ephesians summarize the first three chapters of the book of Ephesians, of the book of Romans. And what we read in the book of Romans, we read, and the book of Romans teaches the total fallenness of men. The first three chapters of the book of Romans tell us about the total fallenness of humankind. The Bible doctrine of depravity, of the total depravity of mankind, is found in these chapters. And the first three verses of Ephesians are a summary. They tell us of the true condition of mankind. They affirm the biblical doctrine of the fallenness of men. And that means that every part of the human person is tainted with sin. Even the best among us, the best of human beings, are tainted with sin. You give me the best Christian ever, the one whose worst sin was to cut their fingernails with their teeth, one who did not use a nail clipper, so perfect, so holy, but in the eyes of God, all of us are fallen, and we come short of the glory of God. No wonder the Apostle Paul begins this chapter in such a disturbing, way. He says, we were dead. Indeed, we were not fainted. The Apostle Paul does not say we were fainted. No, he does not say we were almost dead. No, he doesn't say we were about to die. He doesn't say we were at the throes of death, but he says we were dead in sin. He paints a very grim picture about us human beings. He says we were dead in sins. He's not saying we were fainted in sin. No, he's not saying we were almost dead in sin. No, he's not saying we were about to die in sin. Uh-uh. He's not saying we were at the throes of death, but dead in sin. The Apostle Paul paints a terrible picture. And when you look at verse 3, he includes himself. He says, we were also. So he also is putting himself together with those who were dead in sins. So if we were dead in sins, how did the change come about? The Apostle Paul paints a very grim picture of us. Look at what he says in verse 1. He says, dead in sins, says we were dead in sins. And I want to take a bit of time and look at this verse 1. He says we were dead in our trespasses and sins. What does that mean? What does dead in our trespasses and sin mean? I'll start explaining the word sins. Though he says we're dead in our trespasses and sins, I want to start with sins. Sins is a very interesting word. The Apostle Paul uses the word hamartia, which is a word which means missing the mark. We have heard that over and over and over. Hamartia means missing the mark. It's as if somebody has put a target before you and he is saying, hit the target. The more you try to hit the target, the more you miss it. You try to hit the target, you miss the target. So that's what hamartia means. You see, I like people who sin in the order of hamartia because their hearts are in the right place. They want to do right, but they find themselves like the Apostle Paul doing wrong. They try to do right, but they find themselves doing wrong. They cry out like the Apostle Paul. They say, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of sin? These are the people who sin in the order of hamartia. Their hearts are in the right place. They want to do the right thing, but they keep on missing. They try to do the right thing, but they keep on missing. So the Apostle Paul says, we were dead in our trespasses and in our sins. So the word translated sin there is the word hamartia. And hamartia means missing the mark. According to the Apostle Paul, God has given us a goal of righteousness. He has said we should be righteous, but the more we try, the more we fail. The more we try, the more we fail. And therefore, the Apostle Paul says, we were dead in our trespasses and in our sins. And now, that's hamartia, trying to do the right thing and failing all the time you try. And the Apostle Paul uses also a very interesting word, the word paraptoma. Now, the word paraptoma, that's where we get the word trespass. This word paraptoma is a very interesting word. It comes from the word parapipto. And parapipto is a very troubling word because it is a word that is linked with stubbornness. It is a word that is linked with rebellion. It is a word in the Old Testament we would link it with a. With Pesha. You know, the Pesha and Paraptoma are brother and sister because they say the same thing. You see, a person who sins in the order of Paraptoma, this is a person for whom a line has been drawn or for whom a boundary has been put, and they have been told, It doesn't matter whether it rains or there is thunder or there is fire. Don't cross this line. But the person looks at the line and says, ah, who? Me? I will cross the line. This is a person who sins knowingly. This is a person who sins deliberately. This is a rebel who knows what not to do and they go ahead and do it. This is a rebel. The Apostle Paul says, we were dead in our hamartia and in our paraptoma. Hamartia, we miss the mark. Paraptoma, we don't miss the mark. We go ahead knowingly and do wrong. The Apostle Paul says, we were dead in our trespasses, in our sins and our trespasses. The Apostle Paul, in other words, is saying to us, we are hopeless sinners. We sin unwillingly and we sin willingly. We are slaves of sin. We are rebels. We have rebelled against the kingdom of God. The Apostle Paul says, we were dead in our sins. He goes on to say, we are intentional sinners. When you analyze the words that I've just explained, we are not rebels only. We are intentional sinners. We are continually and perpetually missing the mark. We are like mother crab. Have you noticed a crab? A crab is a very interesting little creature. And one day I am told mother crab was taking her children for a walk. And when they were walking, the little ones were walking ahead of mama. And when mama looked at her children, she realized that these guys were not walking straight and that they were walking sideways. And mama said, guys, who taught you to walk like that? Why are you walking sideways? You should walk straight. The children tried, they tried to walk straight as mama was saying. The more they tried, the more sideways they walked. The more they tried to walk straight, the more they walked sideways. They continued to walk sideways. They continued to walk sideways. Mother crab was so angry and furious. You stop that nonsense. Let me show you how to walk straight. And so the little ones stood there and they watched mother demonstrate how to walk straight. She said, you should walk like this, as she too was walking sideways like her children. That's how fallen we are. We can't walk straight, no matter how much we are told, no matter how much the law of God tells us to walk straight, we continue to walk sideways like a crab. In other words, stealing does not make us thieves. We steal because we are thieves. Lying does not make us liars. We lie because by nature we are liars. Killing does not make us murderers. We murder because by nature we are murderers. My brothers and sisters, this is our universal condition as human beings. No wonder the Apostle Paul says we are dead in our trespasses and sins. No wonder the Apostle Paul says we were dead in our trespasses and in our sins. We are fallen as human beings. For the journey home to be real, this is where the thing starts. You have to realize that you are fallen. If you don't realize that you are fallen, forget about making it home. The journey home begins with you realizing your true picture, your true state before God. If you don't realize that you are not savable, if you don't know that you are a sinner, you are not savable. It's only those who will go down on their knees and say, Father, be merciful to me, a sinner. You remember the story that Jesus told about the publican and the Pharisee. The Pharisee goes to the temple and he says, God, you are so fortunate to have me. You know, I pay tithe. The whole community eats from my house. Of course, I'm paraphrasing. All the people don't have clothes. They are dressed from my house. I do one, I do two, I do three, I do four. Oh, you are so fortunate, my God, to have a person like me. And then the poor publican knelt down. He didn't even look up to heaven. He looked down and said, oh, Gosiam, be merciful to me, a sinner. And then Jesus said, he is the one who went home justified. The journey home begins when you realize that it doesn't matter how many years you have been a pastor. It doesn't matter how many years you have been an elder. You are a sinner in capital letters. That's when you come to that realization, because in the words of Ellen White, in the book Steps to Christ, he says, the closer you come to Jesus, the more sinful you see yourself to be. If you don't see that you are a sinner, you are far from home. But if you see and realize that you are a sinner needing salvation, you are a sinner needing forgiveness, you are closer home. That's what the word of God says. My brothers and sisters, we are fallen. I am still going to read from the word of God to show us how fallen we are. And we call this, some people think it's too strong when I use the word total depravity. My brothers and sisters, according to the Bible, human beings are fallen. It doesn't matter who you are fallen. I am fallen. We all will make it to the kingdom. Not because of what we have done, but because of what he has done. Listen to what the Bible says about our fallenness. No wonder the Bible calls all of us children of wrath. Isaiah says, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our way. Romans chapter 3, verses 11 to 12 says, no one is righteous. No, not one. All have turned aside. Together, they've become worthless. No one does good. Not even one. Jeremiah 17, verse 9 says, the heart of man is desperately wicked. Who can know it? Romans 3, chapter 3, verse 23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. My brothers and sisters, we are indeed children of wrath because we have sinned before God. We are children of wrath, deserving death and destruction. This is our true condition before a holy God. This is us in Ephesians. From verse 1 to 3, the Apostle Paul is not describing them. He's describing us. They were church members like ourselves. He's describing us. We are sinners in capital letters. We are dead in our trespasses. How then did the turnaround come? When you go back to the book, to chapter 1 of Ephesians, it doesn't say you were dead in sins and in your sins and trespasses. Then you turned around and you made things work. It doesn't say you were dead in your trespasses and sins. Then you made up your mind to be good and you became very good. It doesn't say that. The Bible says we were dead in our trespasses and sins. Then how did the turnaround come? Look at verse 4. This is where our salvation hangs. Our salvation hangs on those two words. Our salvation hangs on those two words. But God. But God, who is rich in mercy and his kindness. But God. That's where our salvation. We were dead in our trespasses and sins. But God. It is God. Our turnaround did not begin in ourselves. It begins and ends with God. We were dead in our trespasses and sins, but God. Our salvation hangs entirely on those two words. We were dead, but God. We were enslaved, but God. We were trapped, but God. We were self-destructing, but God. We were lost in sin, but God. We were children of wrath and deserving judgment and death, but God. How do you spell relief from spiritual death and despair? You spell it, but God. We were going to be lost, my brothers and sisters. If it wasn't for God, all of us, pastors and all, we were going to be lost, but God. we were going straight from we were going straight to eternal separation from God. And we know that separation from God means eternal destruction. It means eternal death. We were going straight to eternal separation from God until those great words were pronounced. But God, instead of pouring out his wrath, God will spend eternity showing the immeasurable riches of his kindness to us in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. When you read the rest of verse 4, it says, but God, who is rich in mercy. I like it. You know, this God, according to the Bible, is rich in mercy. He is not only merciful, but he is rich in mercy. He has abundant mercy. He has such mercy that you cannot fully understand. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love. You know, if the Bible had only said, but God, who is merciful and who loves us, that would have been enough. But the Bible uses superlatives here. It says, but God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love. It's not ordinary love. It's great love. And this love in the Old Testament is the chesed love of God. In the New Testament is the agape love. It is a love that does not love us because we are beautiful. It is a love that has seen us at our worst and yet continues to love us. It says, but God, who is rich in mercy, oh my brothers and sisters, let nothing keep you away from God. Let no sin keep you away from God, because our God is rich in mercy because he loves us with great love. He says, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love for us, has made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in sins. Our coming to life was nothing of our doing. It was all of God. It was all of grace. It was because God loves us. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love for us, made us alive. We did not make ourselves alive. We were made alive by God. We were dead in our trespasses and sins, and we were made alive by God and we were brought up with Christ even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and not of yourselves. My brothers and sisters, salvation is nothing of our doing. It is everything of his doing. Mercy is God not giving us what we do deserve. And of course, what we deserve is judgment. Grace is God giving us what we don't deserve. And what we don't deserve by nature is salvation. So God, who is rich in mercy, he gives us what we don't deserve. And because God is a gracious God, he does not give us, because God is a God of mercy, he gives us what we rightfully do not deserve. Grace is God giving us what we don't deserve. One needs to distinguish between grace and mercy. Grace is shown to the undeserving, while mercy is compassion to the miserable. Grace is God's solution to man's sin, and mercy is God's solution to man's misery. Grace covers our sins, while mercy removes the pain. Grace forgives, while mercy restores. Grace gives us what we don't deserve, while mercy withholds what we do deserve. Hallelujah, my brothers and sisters. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. We worship a God who has seen us at our worst and yet continues to love us. Grace is getting what we do not deserve. Justice is getting what we do deserve. Mercy is not giving us what we deserve. I praise God. I really praise him, my brothers and sisters, because the journey home will be made successfully. Those who will make it home successfully are not those who trust on themselves. It is those who kneel down every morning and say, my Father, I am unworthy. I need to be clothed in the righteousness of the Lamb. Those are the only ones Have you read that story in the New Testament? Have you read it? I've read it several times, where the king makes a banquet for his son. And when the king makes this banquet, he sends his servants. He says, go call them. Go call them. Tell them to. Of course, the first group said no. And then God said, go to the highways and the byways. Of course, we know the first group refers to the Jews. They refuse to accept the Son of Man. And God says, go to the highways and the byways. Go and tell them that the supper, the marriage feast of the Lamb is ready. Call everyone, regardless of their condition. Tell them to come. That is the call of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Go to the highways and byways. Go to the gutters of this planet. Call everybody, the drunkards, those who are in the streets, everyone, tell them to come, because God has prepared a banquet for his children. Go call them. And the story says, the servants went and they called the people from everywhere, and the people came, and the hall was filled with people to capacity, and the king was happy. Now I'm going to put it in my own language. And now when the king, when the hall is full, the king comes to inspect his guests. He comes there to inspect everybody. As he comes in, there was this guy. In my own imagination, I think that he had bought himself a brand new suit, maybe from Paris. It was I will pronounce it as we pronounce it. We pronounce it as pericardine. It was a brand new suit, pericardine, you know, shirt Van Heusen, necktie pericardine, you know. The guy was smart man, he was expensive. And so he comes. And he gets to the door. They say, "Sir, when you, as you enter here, you are given the robe." Then he unbuttoned his jacket and showed them the label and said, "No, no, no, I cannot remove a label. You see, I'm putting on something that's imported. This is an import, man." And so they let him sit. And then as the king comes inspecting, he finds this guy. And I love this king. He doesn't get there and start descending on the guy. No, he says to him, "My friend, how is it that you do not have the gown that everybody has?" And the guy says, the Bible says, the man was speechless. He was speechless because he was offered the gown, but he did not want it. He left it. So many of us as Adventists, we are offered the righteousness of Christ for free. We are offered, but we think that we can trust. Oh, you know, it's good to do the good things that we do. But my brothers, those good things that we do are a testimony to the world. Those good things that we do are telling everybody that's how an Adventist lives. For salvation, you need only one name, for there is no other name given among men whereby we can be saved, and that is the name of Jesus. You need to accept his righteousness, my brother. You need, as you journey home, you need the robe that's not manufactured in the looms of earth. You need that robe which is manufactured in the looms of heaven. You need the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And so you will make it on your journey home, because alone you are dead in trespasses and sins. If God does not intervene, if there was no but God in the Bible, you and I would not have had any hope. My brothers and sisters, verses 8 and 9 of the book of Ephesians tell us very clearly, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves." It's not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. My brothers and sisters, the journey home can only be made successfully by those who realize that they are sinners. Oh, read that book by Ellen White, Steps to Christ. She will tell you that education has its own place. But here it is useless. It is useless. She will tell you the willpower has its own place. But when it comes to preparing and ensuring that you make it to heaven, it is useless. She goes on to say, it is like ropes of sand. So don't stop trusting on ropes of sand. Trust in Jesus Christ. We by nature are evil. We by nature are dead in our trespasses and sins. But God, it is my prayer this morning, this afternoon, that God will let his Holy Spirit shine upon us, that we may realize our true condition before God. Because that's when salvation starts. When you see yourself as you truly are in the sight of God, salvation has become. Charles Spurgeon said a beautiful sentence, which I want to quote as I close. He says, a sinner is a very precious thing because the Holy Spirit has told him so. Has the Holy Spirit told you you are a sinner? If the Holy Spirit has told you are righteous, it wasn't the Holy Spirit from heaven. The Holy Spirit of God, he will convict you of sin. The Holy Spirit will show you the beauty of Jesus Christ, and you will see yourself falling far too short. The same Charles Spurgeon says he had a dream. In the dream, he was standing by the gates of heaven. And as he was standing by the gates of heaven, he saw these 12 guys. No, there were more than 12. They were coming and they were singing confidently. They were going home. They were on the journey home and they were about arriving. And as he looked at them, he saw that on the borders of their garments, the hems, they had red hems. And he said, he asked the angels who was standing by the gate, says, but tell me, who are these guys? Oh, the angel said, oh, these are martyrs. They died for their faith. Then Spurgeon said, can I go in with them? And the angel said, no, man, you didn't die for your faith. When, just hold it there. And then he held it back. And he kept on trying to convince the angel to go into heaven. And the angel said, no, man, wait. Don't bother yet. Just stand there. And then he looked and he saw a group of 12. And so as he looked at the 12, he saw them coming. They were walking confidently into the kingdom. They were almost getting home. He said, can I go in with these? The angel said to him, you can't. You are not one of the 12. These are the 12 apostles of the Lamb. You can't go in. So Charles Spurgeon was now disappointed because the angel had been telling him, you can't go in, you can't go in, you can't go in. So he sits there dejected. He says, me, a pastor who has converted many to Jesus Christ, and I can't come in. Huh? So he sits there dejected. And so the 12 walk in. And then as he's looking, he sees this great multitude that's coming and they are singing. They're singing the song of Moses and of the Lamb. They are excited. They are coming. And the Charles Spurgeon looks at them. And as he looks at them, he sees that woman who was caught on the act. Says, that one is not making it. He looks, he sees Manasseh. He says, that Manasseh, could there have been a sinner worse than Manasseh? No, man. He was the king of all sinners. He looks around, he sees people that he knew were terrible people on this planet Earth, sinners to the core. And then Charles Spurgeon says, these are joking. If I, a pastor, have been told not to go in, what about these ones? They're just wasting their time. And he sees those people are coming. They're a large crowd that no one can number. He looks and he sees they're coming confidently as they get closer to the gate. He hears a loud voice coming from the throne of God saying, open wide all the gates of heaven and let my children come in. As they are walking in, Spurgeon runs to the angel man, says, tell me, what's happening here? I know all those guys. I know them. I can even tell you their stories. So how come? How come I cannot come in and those have gone in? Who are they? And the angel says, I think you are right. I agree with you. Those were mighty sinners saved by the mighty grace of Jesus Christ. You too, Charles, can walk in. And so he entered the gates of the kingdom, not by the preaching that he had done, but by the grace of God. Is there perhaps one among us who says, I'm serious about going home. I know myself more than anyone knows me. I'm a sinner in capital letters. Is there anyone perhaps who is saying, Lord, who's saying, my Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner, on this journey home? Is there anyone perhaps today who needs forgiveness as badly as I do? Is there anyone perhaps who's saying, Pastor, pray for me because I want to make it home? On this journey home, Pastor, I'm serious about the journey. But I find myself missing the mark all the time. Is there someone perhaps who says, hey, Pastor, I'm a rebel and God knows I am. Is there someone perhaps who says, pray for me, Pastor. If you are there, my brother, my sister, will you bow your heads with me? If you are there, my child, will you bow your heads with me as we pray? My Father, this is the day for us, where we bow our heads to confess who we truly are. Forgive us, Father. Wash us in the blood of Jesus Christ. Because when we read your word, Baba, we know that you came into the world to seek and to save that which was lost. You said it yourself, that you did not come for the righteous, but you came for people like us. May you wash us, Lord, as we journey home. May you write our names in the book of life, not because we are worthy, but because Jesus is worthy. And may you keep us strong in the faith. May you hold us by your hand until that day shall come when you will usher us into the kingdom, is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We want to thank the pastor for such a powerful message. We thank the Lord that indeed he has used you powerfully to share with us this morning. We are going to close our service in this manner. We will have a slot now to welcome the visitors, and after that we'll have a song from Elder Mberi, and then closing remarks from Elder Ngube, and also just give us a prayer as well. So we'll have the Omos, the song, and Elder Ngube.
Thank you, Elder Chakarisa, and thank you also, Pastor Solomon Maposa, for such a powerful word. We can only remember the two words, but God. Thank you so much for that. I want to just welcome all of you to this program. Thank you all for coming to worship with us during this divine service. Thank you to all our visitors that have been invited. Pastor Maposa, just to show you that we love visitors and they are special to us, we are going to read the names of the visitors that visited us today. We've got Abani Anyati, Amanda Shandu, Armstrong Chiwade, Brian Mange, Dudu Zile, Esther Kemigisha, Ethel Maloba, Happy Macaulay, Sister Mace, Gabriel Allison, Louis Mataswa, Martha Romberi, the one who gave us the song, Machu Volo, Nkosana Sibanda, Nono for Hlomeleng, Ntando Bebe, Ntabiseng Letsatsi, Pamit Zaidima, Pindi Tsindi, my sister there, Pumla Nteo, Poshia Maluma, Priscilla Mhlophe, Rudairo Tumba, Ruten de Chitando. Allow me to tell you that this is my family all the way in Gutu. They are worshiping with us in there in Gutu. Seti Mpofu, Sitlo Bo Senko Simpofu, Stephen Makoni, Susan Mchali, Tandingambule, Zivaita Puma, Ellen Malao. Thank you all for joining us today. And there's also Tuli M. Thank you for joining us. We are so thankful that God allowed us to hear this powerful message that we have learned today, where we are being reminded that on this journey home, let us not forget that we are sinners and we can only be saved by God himself. Thank you so much. For those that want the book Steps to Christ, you might have heard the pastor mentioning the book Steps to Christ. Please leave your numbers in the chat. We'll send you the PDF of Steps to Christ. And also, if you want to do some Bible lessons that we call VOP, you will learn quite a lot about the Bible. Also leave your number there. And or if you want special prayer, or if there's something you want to say to us, or I don't know, anything. And there's also stories of baptism. If you want to know more about our church, and if you don't belong to our church, you want to know more about our church. By our church, I don't mean Golden Harvest Church. I mean the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Please leave your number as well. We want to also thank the church members who joined us and other Adventist church members who came from different churches. I'm inviting all of you to join us as we end the week of prayer in the evening. We are going to have a program at 5:30 p.m. South African time, 3:30 p.m. UK time. We'll be having the Team Zunde, the four men, I was going to call them young. Yeah, but they're still young. The four men to preach to us as we close our week of prayer. Let's all come and we close together as we continue to pray, praying until something happens that time. Thank you, Elder Chakarisa. I now hand over back to you.
Thank you very much for the welcome for visitors. We shall now have our closing song at this time from Elder Mberi. And after the closing song, if Elder Ngubo, you can step in and do the closing remarks.
Good afternoon, Church.
Amen.
I take this time to thank all the visitors and the church members who attended this service today. And I pray that may God richly bless you as we worship him together today on this Sabbath. From prayer bands, somewhere we've been together. But I take this time to ask my pastor, our local pastor, Pastor Madava, to thank our president of the SID in terms of protocol. Yes, in terms of being the elder on duty today, I can do it, but I'll ask my pastor to thank our president for being with us in this service and for preaching to us. The president said, but God, but I'll say, but God's grace, if the president can include that in his topic next time when he preaches to us, but God's grace is sufficient for us. And through it all, it's only but God's grace. Pastor Madava, can I kindly ask you to thank the president, Pastor Maphosa, for being with us and for saving us today. And I also want to thank Brother Mberi for the beautiful songs that touched my heart so much. For the church members and our visitors, 5:30 is the time that you cannot miss today as we close our week of prayer. I invite all of you that let's join together again 5:30 to close the Sabbath. Pastor Madava, it's your time.
Thank you, Elder Ncube. On behalf of Golden Harvest, the leadership and the members at large, we would love to send our heartwarming appreciation to the SID President, Pastor Solomon Maphosa. Thank you for honoring the appointment and thank you for allowing God to use you so mightily as he did today. May God bless you and your family.
Just render a prayer for us, Pastor, before you leave the platform.
Our eyes are closed. Let us pray together. Our kind and loving Father, what above, we are left without words. We have been told by heaven tonight, today, indeed we are sinners. Some of these sins, dear Father, are due to our desire to do good, but finding ourselves not hitting the mark. Some of them, dear Father, are deliberate. We deliberately choose not to follow you and do what you call us to do. But even establish this, Father, we are reminded that we have a Savior in Jesus Christ. And Lord, we come before the throne of grace, even as we journey home, that may you prepare us for the home that is to come. We pray for each and every single member. We pray for each and every single person who will have the privilege of listening to this message. May you speak to us, Lord, that amidst all things, all evil, God is abundant in mercy, great love to his people. Bless us, Lord, we pray, and keep us this Sabbath and make us holy as you are. But above all, Father, prepare us for your coming, even as we look around and see the signs of times that testifies that indeed he who is to come will come, and surely he shall not tarry. May this be our experience, Lord, even as we await your coming. Bless us, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you very much, Pudisi. And can we have a song from our host that ushers us out? Let's have a song. Let's meet again at 5:30. Thank you. May God bless you.
Okay, thank you.